Okay. Well, we continue our series on the ancient truths, refreshing our mind or a fresh look at ancient truths. And we're going to talk about prayer this morning. And prayer is like the Holy Spirit. Prayer is like the Trinity. It's a great mystery. I pray different from you. You pray different from me. We all have different fingerprints, right? And we all have different personalities. We all have different prayer styles. But really what prayer is, it's an encounter with God. We can't control God as we can't totally understand the Holy Spirit. We can't totally understand the Trinity. We can't understand all that God has for us, including His infinite love. But really, prayer is about an encounter with God. One of the favorite things I love to do is to walk with my wife. We go out to Pie Trainer Park, you know where that is, North Park, and there's all these paths in the woods that we like to walk in. We take our 17-year-old dog, who can't see, can't hear, but can still walk. And you know, it's a time where we engage with each other. We talk. She talks and I listen. She talks and I listen. She talks and I listen. Guys, you know what that's all about. We're like a bump on the log. We listen. And then I talk and she listens. And it's not just a sharing of information. You know, we go through our day, but then we get on a deeper level and we actually encounter each other and we engage with each other and we get three things done with one stone. We get exercise, we catch up with each other, and the dog gets exercise and is happy and will sleep the rest of the day. So, isn't that what prayer is all about? Prayer is about a conversation, walking, talking, listening to God. And I want us to turn this morning in our scripture to Luke chapter 10, starting at verse 38. And we're going to go through chapter 10. Verse 4. Let's pray silently together. Lord, as we prepare for communion this morning, we pray that through your word, you might open our eyes that we might see ancient truths, wonderful things from your word. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Starting at verse 38, listen to the word of God. As Jesus and his disciples were on their way, Jesus came to a village where a woman named Martha opened her home to him. And she had a sister called Mary who sat at the Lord's feet listening to what he said. But Martha was distracted by all the preparations that had to be made. She came to him and asked, "Lord, don't you care that my sister has left me do the work by myself? Tell her to help me." Martha, Martha, when you hear a word repeated twice in Scripture, a name repeated twice, that means closeness and intimacy. "Martha, Martha," the Lord answered, "you are worried and upset about many things, but only one thing is needed. And Mary has chosen what is better, and it will not be taken away from her." Who are you, Martha or Mary? You know, the sitting at Jesus' feet, that's the way a person would sit with a rabbi who taught. And Mary did the better thing, although Martha was doing important things. I don't know about you, but I'm kind of in between. One day I'm Martha and one day I'm Mary. Usually Mary on my day off. It's Martha doing all this other stuff for the Lord. But I find that in a day that I work, if I sit at the Lord's feet and take more time in prayer, I get more done. And I have more energy. Mary did the better thing. And we keep on here. One day Jesus was praying in a certain place. And when he finished, one of his disciples said to him, "Lord, teach us to pray just as John taught his disciples. Isn't it interesting? The disciples never asked Jesus, teach me how to do a miracle. Teach me how to raise somebody from the dead. Teach me how to preach. Teach me how to teach. Teach me how to turn water into wine. But they did say this, teach me how to pray. Because they had heard Jesus pray. And they knew that's where his power, that's where his love, that's where his intimacy came from. And Jesus said to them, when you pray, say this, our Father, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Give us each day our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, for we also forgive everyone who sins against us. And lead us not into temptation. So we ask the question, and I'd like to invite you, forgot about this, I've actually got an outline. If you look on the back of the stewardship page, there's an outline there you can follow. This is more of a teaching, I think, this morning, a practical teaching. I'd like you to take notes or just to follow along. You can stick that in your Bible and take it home. It might be a jump start to prayer for you. But we ask the question, what is prayer? One person said it's a conversation with God. Someone else said this, I love this, not knowing about God, but knowing God. O. Hallisby, in his classic book called Prayer, and that's printed down at the bottom of your notes, these three books that I've used for this sermon. He said this, as far as I can see, prayer has been ordained only for the helpless. Helplessness and prayer are inseparable. Have you ever come to the end of yourself? That's when you learn how to pray. And that's what happens in our life. In fact, Tim Keller says in his book on prayer, prayer is simply connecting Jesus to our absolute helplessness. Jesus put it this way, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of God. And I love what Martin Luther, the great reformer, said. He said, prayer is a dialogue. It's listening and talking. We listen to God primarily through the Scripture, and then we respond to God through prayer. And I want to do a little example for you. Say this is you and me. And this water is Scripture. And I forgot my rag, but that's okay. If we soak ourselves in God's Word, which is Scripture, and just soak and soak and sit at Jesus' feet, and then when the pressures of life come along, as they will, and they squeeze us with the troubles and the conflict and all those things in life, what comes out? It's God's Word, God's character, God's attributes, our calling and our helplessness to God. And true life comes out. Instead of bitterness, we become closer to God. So, Martin Luther gives us a way, really a simple way to pray. But what are the requirements to prayer? Well, first of all, I believe we have to be children of God, born from above. If you'll turn with me or just listen to me over to John chapter 1, verses 12 and 13. Before we can pray, we have to have Jesus, the Holy Spirit, Father in our lives. John says this, yet to all who received him, have you received him? To those who believe in his name, do you believe in his name? Not intellectual assent, but really believe. He gave the right to become a child of God. Are you a child of God? Children born not of natural descent, nor of human decision, but born of God. You see, there's a physical birth. We've all gone through that because we're all here. We're physical human beings. But there's also a spiritual birth where we have to be born again to receive the things of God and learn how to pray. Some of you know the time and the date where you were born again. I know, March 1975, I had a conversion experience like Paul on the Damascus Road. Some of you don't know the time and date. You're like Timothy, where he was brought up in a Christian household. He never knew a day without the Lord because he had Lois and Eunice who taught him the faith, his mother and grandmother. It doesn't matter, but we have to be born from above to learn how to pray. Jesus said to Nicodemus, you must be born again to receive the kingdom of God. Have you been born again, either Timothy's way or Paul's way? If you've been born again, you know it. If you don't, come to the Lord today. Make a commitment to Him. You get tired of living for yourself. Live for the Lord and other people. It's a lot better life. So we have to be children of God, requirements for prayer. And secondly, we have to have the discipline of prayer, and Jesus is our model. If you look back to Mark chapter 1, verse 35. This is so hard to do, isn't it? Not looking for the scripture, but actually doing what Jesus did. Verse 35 says, very early in the morning, while it was still dark, Jesus got up, left the house, and went off to a solitary place where he prayed. So he had to get alone with God. And for him, early in the morning was the place that he could get alone for God. And I don't know about you, but in Pittsburgh in the winter when it's so dark, it's hard to get up. My wife gets up at 5. She's a real saint. I get up at 6. That's tough. But to get a solitary place and a time to pray, for Jesus is our model. Tim Keller said this, prayer should be done regularly, persistently, resolutely, or at least daily, whether we feel like it or not. If you want to grow in Christ, we need to learn how to pray. P.T. Forsyth said this, the worst sin for a Christian is prayerlessness. Yeah, it is all about grace. But if we really want to grow in the Lord, we have to immerse ourselves in Scripture and learn how to pray. And we ask the Lord, teach us how to pray. We can't do it ourselves. We need the Lord inside of us to teach us how to pray. So how do we pray? Well, I think one way we learn how to pray is we have to have a spiritual model. Yes, Jesus is our model in Scripture, but do you have someone out there who is a prayer warrior, someone who knows how to pray, and you've been around them and they've taught you in a way? I remember my grandmother, Mama Lou. She was a pastor's daughter. She was a pastor's wife. She had learned how to pray since she was an early age. When I was a teenager, I was troubled and would live with my parents for 9 months out of the year, my junior and senior year. But they sent me off to Daytona Beach or Ormond Beach in the summer to live with my grandmother because they had had enough of me. And my grandmother gave me total freedom. I mean, it was great. Daytona Beach, summer 74, 75, total freedom. Because she prayed for me and she believed in her prayers. But I remember in the summer sometimes when I'd come in late at night, not in the best shape possible. She was in the back room with the door closed praying for me. How do I know? Because Mama Lou was deaf and she thought God was deaf and she prayed very loudly. And when she prayed, she was very specific. And she was praying for me. She said, bring Kevin to Christ. Open up your word to him. One day, and I hated this prayer, one day I want him to be a pastor. If that's your will, bring him to be a pastor. Talk about being haunted, convicted. I needed more grace. But you know, summer of 74 and the summer of 75 when I was there, there was a presence in that house. And I felt God's presence. And she had given me a Bible. She gave me a Bible every year. I was 17. I probably had 17 Bibles, different versions. And I had the Living Way. And I was reading the Living Way. And God began to come alive to me. And she taught me how to pray. She cried out to God. She was real with God. It's none of this King James language. Oh, they're all great. She said, bring Kevin to Christ. Feed him. Let him get into your word. I want him to become a pastor. Please don't pray that. I want him to become a pastor. God answered her prayers. So, how do we pray? Martin Luther was a great man of prayer. In fact, Martin Luther, there was a man who heard Martin Luther, the great reformer, preach. His name was Wieck Dietrich. And he said this in Tim Keller's book on prayer. He said, there's not a day in which he does not devote at least 3 hours to prayer. The very ones most suitable for work to pray. Once I was fortunate enough to overhear his prayer. Good God, what faith in his words. He speaks with the great reverence of one who speaks to his God and with the trust and hope of one who speaks with his Father and friend. You see, Martin Luther knew God. He knew that God was holy, 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 and he had deep reverence for him, but he also knew that God was love and he had a deep friendship with God. And when this guy heard him pray, he was a model for prayer. Martin Luther also had a barber whose name was Peter Beskendorf. And Peter Beskendorf, you know, trimmed his beard and did his haircut. And Peter Beskendorf was a devout man who wanted to learn how to pray, but he was a very flawed man like you and me. And one night, Peter Beskendorf was having dinner with his family, and he got intoxicated. He took a knife, and he stabbed his son-in-law to death. That's why I drink in a moderate way, you know. It's maybe a glass of wine, maybe a beer, because, you know, I love my family, but you know how family can get. No sharp knives in our house. Anyway, because of Martin Luther's influence, he was able to get this barber, instead of executed, he got him exiled, and he continued to be his barber and cut his beard. And the barber asked Martin Luther, teach me how to pray. Teach me a simple way to pray. And this is what Martin Luther taught him, and it's a simple way to pray if you want to take some notes on this. He said, first of all, you need to be in God's Word. You need to soak yourself in God's Word. And the barber did. And then he said, meditate on God's Word. In other words, take something in God's Word. You need to be reading God's Word every day, whether it's through the gospel or a devotional or something like that, to be in God's Word every day and ponder His words. You know, it's not about a speed race, it's about a marathon. We're to read God's Word in a pondering way. What's the big idea of the text for that day? What in God's Word is speaking to you personally? Sit with it for a while. Ponder it. Think about it. And then from that word, begin to praise God for what you learned in the text. Praise God for His character that you learned in the text. Praise God for His attributes that you might learn in the text. And then move on to penance or repentance. What in that text convicts you of your sin? You know, Scripture is there to comfort us, and it does, but it's also there to convict us, and it does. Sometimes we don't want to read Scripture because we might be lazy, we're out of the habit, but we don't want to be convicted of our sin. But that's part of God's work through Scripture to convict us of our sin, that we might repent. And then petition. Pray this truth, this text, this big idea, this phrase, this word over yourself and over those who you love and over your pastors. Please pray for your pastors, over your elders, over your deacons, over the church. And then finally, sit in silence with that word. In fact, J.I. Packer says in his book on prayer, it's a great title, Prayer, Finding Our Way Through Duty to Delight. Isn't that great about prayer? Finding our way through duty to delight. He says, J.I. Packer, great theologian, pastor, says this, there is indeed a place for silence before God. After we have spoken to Him, while joy at God's love invades the soul. It is appropriate sometime to admire and adore God silently, because when two people love each other, there are times when they smilingly look at each other in silence, not needing to speak, simply enjoying their close fellowship. You know, when Betsy and I walk, you know, it might be an hour and a half, we need to get back into that. There's times we don't talk. We just enjoy the beauty of nature. We enjoy each other's company. We don't need to talk. We don't feel nervous that we have to talk all the time. There's something about a deep intimacy with a person that you love that understands you, that understands your goodness and your sins and loves you unconditionally. And that's what God wants with us. God doesn't need that from us. He has a relationship, God the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, a relationship of the Trinity that just enjoy each other. But He created us, the crown jewel of His creation, and He desires to have that intimate fellowship with us. But we need to give Him time. We need to be born again. We need to be His children and take time to get to know the great God of the universe, to have a personal encounter with Him. So, how do we do this in a practical way? Let's take the Lord's Prayer, and let's take that first phrase, Our Father. Meditate about that. What does that mean to you, Our Father? Well, the first word is our. It means that I have a father, and you have a father, and it's our father, which makes us brother and sister. You know, you hear the Pentecostals and the Baptists say, hey, brother, hey, sister, you know, like that. Well, I like to say that too, because I really believe it. You're my brother, you're my sister. In fact, my family's either dead or they live far away. This is my family right here. It's you, whether you like me or not. It doesn't work to be a Lone Ranger Christian. Just you and God, just you and God. You don't need anybody else. It's good to be in a fellowship. It's like being in a family. The more you put yourself into that family, the more chance you have of being hurt and need to give forgiveness. But it's no fun to be alone, is it? So ponder about our. And then what about father, daddy, a relationship with a father? Think about that, that the God of the Bible might be different than our father. None of us have perfect fathers, but He is the perfect father. And He can take us in. The scripture says, even though your mother and father forsake you, I will receive you. God is both mother and father. He's the perfect parent. He wants intimacy. He wants closeness. He wants to love us unconditionally. He wants to forgive us. Our Father. So we meditate about that. We praise God for His attributes of Father. We praise God that we have a family, that we don't have to live alone. We can repent and confess our sin over that phrase. We can pray that phrase over another person. And then we can spend time in silence. What do we praise God for? Well, He's our Father. He's our provider. He's our protector. In this prayer, He comes first. There's something about putting God first in our lives that we can concentrate on Him and not think about ourselves all the time. You ever get sick of yourself? It's great to look up and not look in the mirror all the time. That's something we can praise God for. We can confess. You know, I'm an introvert. I get my energy from being alone. I love being in a family, but I could be perfectly happy just to sit in front of the TV, ESPN, and watch basketball game after basketball game after basketball game and just keep going. By the way, Pitt needs your prayers this year. They're awful. You know, if Coach Stallings would come here, you know, we could lay hands on him, pray all over him. Maybe that would help. I don't know where he goes to church. I don't know how I got off on this. Where are we? But think about our Father confessing our sin in regard to that. I think about my own father. I had a great father, but he was not perfect. He was that greatest generation that his big thing was to work hard and to provide for his family. Give him 3 squares, give him a shelter, you know, give him an education, take him to church, give him religion, and then they're on their own. That was my dad. He was a great prayer. But he had a hard time with relationships. He had a hard time with intimacy because his dad had a hard time with intimacy. And his dad's dad abandoned the children. So look at how that comes down through the family. And then there's me. And I had to come to grips with that and say, Lord, I confess my sin before you that I compare you to my dad. I thank you for my dad. He was a great dad. I thank you for him, but he's imperfect. Forgive me for trying to think that he's perfect. Help me to forgive him and help me to worship you, that you are the perfect God. I had to confess that sin before the Lord, and I had to ask God, in terms of myself, when you get down to petition, help me to be a better father to my children than my father might have been to me. Help me to learn from his mistakes. And God has taught me how to do that. I think I have a good, close relationship with my kids, but I tend to try to escape. I tend to be a loner. I tend to get away, and I need to confess that. And then pray that our Father over your own family and your friends. Pray that they might be in a family like a church family. Pray that they might have a personal encounter with the loving God of the universe. Pray for them. You know, when we pray in this manner, this might be a jump start to your prayer life. You can spend a lot of time in prayer and then close in silence. Just sit there and think about, man, I've got a family. I've got a daddy. Be still and know that I am God. And I am a perfect God who loves you and forgives you. And I want to have an encounter with you. And our prayer should be, Lord, teach us how to pray. You know, in conclusion, I've been here many years, and I've been praying that this church, that I would become a man of prayer, that this church would become a house of prayer. We spent many hours in this sanctuary praying for this church and praying for the community. And we still have that revival prayer here on Wednesday morning. Every other Wednesday morning, the second and fourth Wednesday morning from 7:30 to 8:30. Invite you to come. We are praying, and we pray that our prayers would shake this church, would shake this community, would shake this city, would shake the nation. We're in need of prayer. Our church is in need of prayer. The city's in need of prayer. This community has so many needs. Our nation. Boy, if we don't start praying, we don't have a lot left. But you know, the Lord convicted me several years ago. And I think I've shared this story with you before, but I'll share it again. When we took our youngest son to Grove City, Evan, John Hunter and Betsy and I took Evan up to Grove City. John Hunter was a senior there, and Evan was going to be a freshman. When I took John Hunter to school, he was my first child, I cried like a baby all 40 minutes. In fact, I had to get Betsy to drive back. He's like 45 minutes away. It's not like he's in the Marines overseas or anything like that. But when I dropped Evan off, I was like happy. I was really excited about that, you know, date night, you know, get some free time, more basketball games, you know. But we moved Evan into his room, and Betsy started really weeping. And John Hunter said, "Why are you crying, Mom? I'll take care of him. I'll look after him. I'm going to get him into my fraternity." That's something to pray about. And Betsy said this. She said, "You know, I'm not worried about Evan. I've got to go back with him." And she pointed to me, and I looked back to see if anybody was in. It was me. And I thought, this is not good. I need to change. I need to engage or something. That's when we started walking in the afternoons. That's when we started reading scripture together and praying together. I know you guys think that I'm a super saint, and Dean and Betsy, and we pray with our wives and families all the time. We're human. We're broken like you. We struggle at this stuff. But Betsy and I started getting up in the morning, and we started reading scripture together and talking about the scripture. And then we hold hands and we pray together. She always gets me because I keep looking at my watch. Come on, let's go. But it's brought us to a deeper place. After 30 years of marriage, we're more in love with each other. We're at a deeper place than we were before. It's because of prayer. It's because of God's grace. It's about soaking ourselves in God's Word.